Wednesday evening. Well, we missed last night. I apologize for that, but I want to try to get us a little something here to get us through the rest of the week by. Tonight, we're going to be in the book of Job. Book of Job in chapter 2. Before we start, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, again, thank you for this day. Lord, thank you again for all the many blessings you've given us. Lord, we just ask now that you help us in your word. Lord, to pray, Lord, that you'll take it. And Lord, that you'll give us something for the days to come. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you'll just help us, Lord, and give us what we need. And Lord, we just want to come to you thanking you and praising you, Lord, for all that you've done, Lord, and all that you're going to do. And these things we ask in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen. So if I look here in the book of Job, I look at this, and I know there's times I've got up and tried to preach, and, you know, sometime I didn't know what to do. Well, this is a message on it. The name of it would be, What to Do When You Don't Know What to Do. And sometimes we can get in that predicament. But I want to lift just one verse of scripture right here, and then we'll come back and pick up some others as we go. But let's look at Job chapter 2 in verse 8. We see here that where Job, Satan's come along, and God said, boy, have you considered my servant Job? And, you know, and God let the devil just go and do. He said, but don't kill him, you know. He don't want you to, but you go in there and you do what you think you need to do. I'm just kind of paraphrasing a little bit. But anyway, he took everything he had from him, and it was just him and his wife. But Satan come back one more time, and he allowed him to go to, and he touched Job's body. He didn't kill him, but he touched his body. And here in verse 8, it says, after he'd had boils and all come up on him, and he said he took him a potsherd to scrape himself withal, and he sat down among the ashes. And you think, well, what good is that? Well, in this time of trouble, the first thing he did, he's going to wait on the Lord. So that's what he done. He waited on him. If you look over here in Job in chapter 1, in verse 20, it said, and Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshiped. Here it is, after he got the news, he just fell down and worshiped. He didn't try to run out into the community and out to his sons and daughters' houses and see what happened and where his flocks was gone. No, he just got down upon the ground and worshiped. Verse 21, he said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Then he says, blessed be the name of the Lord. In verse 22, in all this Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. He just sat down and waited. He waited on God. He trusted him up to now. He said, there's no need to doubt him now. But if you look here, when trouble comes, you know, the first thing we do is we'll call out and we'll say, you know, we need your prayers. And that's what we need to do. We need to look out for each other. We need to call on each other to pray for one another. And here we see that when trouble comes, you know, pray. But don't stop there. What's prayer without worship? No matter what the circumstances are, we need to worship God because he's in control. He knows what we need. And he's going to help us just like all this is going on now in this world today. He's doing it for a reason. He knows what we need. If we'll just wait, pray, we need to worship at the same time. Don't ever stop worshiping. And just seek the Lord. Don't try to fix these things on your own. Sometimes if we move too fast on certain things, you know, we try to go in there and try to fix things without consulting God with it. We kind of get in a hurry and we'll mess up sometimes. And, you know, we just make the wrong move. It's kind of like, you know, in February, a lot of time in February, we'll get a few nice, warm, pretty days. I mean, it'll get up 60, 70 degrees and be really nice and make you want to go fishing and even make you want to go down there and plant a garden. But we know better because the pretty days in February aren't going to last. But if we'll wait till about May, then we can plant our gardens and everything's going to be okay. If you look to Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 29 through 31, we'll see the future in waiting. Verse 29 says, he giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even though the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young man shall utterly fall. Verse 31, and we've used this before. I've preached on this before too, but it says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. There's a lot of truth in that verse of scripture right there. We can use that for everyday life. The first part you look at, your strength will be renewed. There's times we get tired, we get weary, we just think we can't get up and go anymore. But God will give us the strength to get up and go again if we'll just look to Him for it. Your soaring shall be returned. There you're talking about when you mount up on the wings, you know. Mounting up on those eagles' wings and soaring again. Your soaring will return to you. And then it says that your steps shall be regained. He's talking about run and not be weary. I used to run in track in high school, and I used to run cross country. Wasn't nothing to run 8-10 miles a day. And I got a little tired, but I done it enough to where I finally got to where I could do it. It didn't bother me so much, you know. If I was to try it now, you'd have to send somebody out to come and get me and pick me up, because I probably wouldn't make it very far. And then it says, your steadfastness, you know, we see that, shall be retained. Where he says, walk and not faint. Can I tell you, sometimes we may get down, but we're not out if we're one of God's own. We look to Him. A lot of people, you hear that old saying there, they say, you know, down and out, or out for the count. Well, we might get down from time to time, but if we'll wait on the Lord and pray and worship Him, we won't ever be out. And then the second thing that we see here in this passage of Scripture is we see that we need to watch, you know. First we wait, and then we watch. Watch yourself first. Looking back over in Job in the first chapter, verse 22, and it says, in all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. You know, he didn't go out and sin. He didn't go out and curse and just get mad. He didn't do anything or charge God foolishly. He knew that whatever God had done was for a reason. And then if we look over in Job chapter 2 and verse 10, it says, he's talking to his wife there, but he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil? In all this did not Job sin with his lips. So we can look and we can see that in times of trouble, there's going to be all kinds of advice you'll be getting and all that. But the best two things we can do is wait and watch. I know that, and we see here, we go on through the book of Job, and Job had some friends, you know, that and when you first start out, you think, well, these are his buddies. They've come to help him out. Really and truly, they wasn't any help at all. But there, you got to watch your so-called friends. Job 2:11, he said, now when Job's three friends heard all the evil that was come upon him, they came every one from his own place. You know, they all left and they come there. But as time goes on, as you read through the book of Job, as time goes on, some of them were not giving him such good advice, you know. But we can lean on our church family to, you know, to be there. And we need to go to them for advice. But what we see here is a lot of times, if you go looking to some of your friends that's out in the world, they're not going to have much good advice to give you. You need to go to your church family, your family. You know, go to the man of God. You need to go to the ones that are in touch with God that's going to help you. But sometimes it's amazing how many people know what God wants for you before you even know it. That's what we see through there. And then another part we see, you know, watch out for Satan's fiery darts. Because when you're down, that's when he's going to kick you the hardest. You get down, he's going to kick even harder and harder. And every time you turn around and you think things will get a little bit better, you catch another one of his fiery darts. You know, you watch for that. But then we need to watch for the Savior's faithfulness. He'll always be there. He's never let us down. He's never, you know, he says he'll never leave us nor forsake us. But remember the Savior's faithfulness in times of trouble. The third part we look at, you know, we waited, we watched, but now he talks about worship. It's always in order to worship the Lord. He is worthy. There is no difference between Job's day and our day. When a Christian has tragedy strike, you know, that's going to tell the truth right there. If tragedy strikes, are we still praising God? We can see that Job and all this that happened, he still worshiped God. He still praised Him through that. we got to, you know, we've got to remember that He's always faithful. He's true to us. You know, we don't never need to see to stop worship. But the reason we see this, because some say that how could Job worship God in these circumstances being what they are? Well, the reason that was Job's worship was not based on his feelings. You think, well, how can you worship without feelings? Well, we looked at a few things here. His materialism was gone, but he still worships. There again in Job 1 and 20, you know, 21, it said he rose and rent his mantle. He shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshiped. And all that stuff he done, he didn't go after anything else. He worshiped the Lord. And we come down and all this, and there again at the end of that, you know, and all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. The second part we can look, his mate was growling. You know, his materialism was gone, now his mate was growling. Job 2, 9 and 10 said, thus said his wife unto him, dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. There it is, like we said in one. How shall we receive the good at the hand of God, and shall not receive evil? In all this did not Job sin with his lips. So even though his wife was upset, he was still trying to tell her, listen, we need to still worship God. And then we see his misery was great. In verse 7 it said, so went Satan forth from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his feet unto his crown. You know, his misery was great. Can you imagine having sores and boils all over your entire body? How miserable that would be. But yet, he still worshiped. Job 13:15 says, though he slay me, yet will I thrust him, but I will maintain mine own ways before him. He said, no matter what goes on, no matter what happens, I'm going to maintain my ways before the Lord. He's never left me, and he's never forsaken me, and he never will. And then another part here, Job, he had the promise of resurrection. In Job 19:23-27, he says, oh, that my words were now written. Oh, that they were printed in a book, that they were graven with an iron pen and lead in the rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter days upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God. Whom shall I see for myself? And mine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. See, Job had to face the fact that he might die in all his condition. But if he did, he knew that death wouldn't be the end of it. Church, that's what we've got. We've got the promise of the resurrection. If you're a child of God, you're born again, you're saved and bought by the blood, death isn't going to be the end of it. We've got the promise of the resurrection. And then he had the perception of his Redeemer. And you look over in Job 23:8-12, it says, behold, I go forward, but he's not there, and backward, but I cannot perceive him. On the left hand, where he doth work, but I cannot behold him. He hideth himself on the right hand, that I cannot see him. But he knoweth the way that I take. When he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. My foot hath held his steps. His way have I kept and not declined. Neither have I gone back from the commandments of his lips. I have esteemed the words from his mouth more than my necessary food. So what he's saying here, and this holds true to us too, when I don't know where he is, he knows where I am. That was what Job said. That's what we can say. That's what we can look to. No matter, if we don't know where he is, but he always knows where we are. And then, when I can't see him, he sees me. Aren't you glad he sees you? He sees you every step you take. You're never out of his sight. And then when I can't hear him, he hears me. He hears the cry of his children. He hears the cry of one of his. Just like when Jesus was on the sea of Galilee with the disciples, and he was laying in the boat asleep, and the storm just crashing and the wind was blowing, and the disciples was afraid and they were scared, and they thought, well, this is it. We're going to drown. This is it. And they went back and they woke Jesus up and asked him, and just paraphrasing here, he said, did you not fear that we die, you know? And he tells them, you know, where's their faith at? But yeah, he just stands up and he just tells the storm to cease, and it did. See, can I tell you, he's always there with us, and he's always there to get us through the storm. But the storm didn't wake up with Jesus. It wasn't the thunder, the lightning, and the rain that woke him up. It was the cries of his children that woke him up. That's what we see in Job. Praise God, he's always been there for me. He promised in his word he'll never leave us nor forsake us. And that's the gospel. He'll never leave us, forsake us. We may quit on him. We may turn our back on him. We may think, well, God, what's the use? But he'll never leave us nor forsake us. That's a little bit of message that the Lord put on my heart this week. I hope it's a blessing to you. I hope it's a help. I'm just praying for we can get back in together at Wolf Creek soon, and we can gather together and worship again together. But until then, we can still worship the Lord day by day, whatever is thrown at us from this old world. Heavenly Father, Lord, again, thank you for what you've done for us today. Lord, thank you again for your word. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you'll help all those that are in need. I pray, Lord, you'll be with Wolf Creek. Lord, I pray that you'll put a hedge of protection around them. And Lord, that you'll just help them in the days that, Lord, they'll look to you for all their needs. Lord, again, we just want to thank you for all that you've done. Tell you, Lord, we love you and we praise you. For it's in Jesus' name we ask these things for his sake.